are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring. Hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us. Worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come out.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Our reading today is taken from St. John's Gospel, chapter 12, beginning to read at verse 12. The Triumphal Entry. The next day, the great crowd that had come for the feast heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Blessed is the King of Israel!" Jesus found a young donkey and sat upon it, as it is written, "Do not be afraid, O daughter of Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt." At first his disciples did not understand all this. Only after Jesus was glorified did they realize that these things had been written about him, and that they had done these things to him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Who, me? I think you've got the wrong guy. For me to tell you otherwise, then I'd be telling a lie. You see, nobody's ever ridden me. It's not a thing I do. Go check out the stallion next door. He'd be more use to you. But still they insisted, and off we went for a walk. And I met this man called Jesus, who persuaded me we could talk. He rode me into Jerusalem. The crowd, they got excited. A special carpet laid for me, and many who sung and shouted, "The King of Kings, the Chosen One." And I had played my part. Little did I realise that this was just the start.
Good morning. Welcome. It's Palm Sunday. Hosanna. Hallelujah. We are marking the beginning of our week through Holy Week to Easter Day and then Easter season. And today we're marking once again the Palm Sunday, Jesus' entry into Jerusalem. And so as we join in and we imagine that scene and we join in with the crowds who are crying out for their king, let's spend a moment now and cry out in prayer to our God to come and speak to us. Heavenly Father, King of Kings, who came on a donkey to Jerusalem as the King of Israel, we pray now that you would come and teach us by your Spirit. Help us search our hearts that we may discover what are we crying out for, and that we would know you and be able to journey with you closely to this day and over this week. Jesus, we ask in your name. Amen. So imagine the buzz of that festival feel that comes around. You know, we get it at Christmas around here, don't we? There's this sort of feeling of energy and excitement and people gathering, and there's lots going on. And that's like Jerusalem just before the Passover. All the Jewish people come to Jerusalem and stay in the city or the surrounding villages so that they can all come and visit the temple. And there's a festival feel, there's a buzz, there's an excitement. And then they hear Jesus is coming. There's a rumor that goes round. It causes shockwaves. And they're like, "Oh, have you heard about this man Jesus? He teaches really well. He brings miracles. Have you heard? Our cousin got healed by him." And they come out, they realize that he could be the Messiah. Is this the king? People say he's the king. We should go out and welcome him. And so they do. And so Jesus comes to Jerusalem as their king, and they're crying out to him, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel." But they have a certain thing in mind. They're longing for that deliverance, because you know what? Hosanna translates roughly as, It kind of almost translates better in Shakespeare and English. It's sort of roughly, I pray thee, I beseech thee, I beg thee, save us. It's sort of more or less, save us, we pray. We ask, save us. They're crying out to their king. Hosanna! Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Save us! Save us! And of course, the people of Jerusalem have one thing in mind. A king who will kick out the Romans and bring back Jewish rule and Jewish autonomy. Kind of respect again to their nation status. They had this thing in mind, and yet what they get is the kingdom king. They get Jesus coming, riding on a donkey. He's not on a great war horse. He's not on a charger. He's not a great military figure. He comes because he is the king of the kingdom of God. He comes in weakness. He comes in humility. This is the servant king. Jesus is taking the idea of kingship, that power-centered person in a nation, and turning it on its head and saying that the king is the servant, the lowliest. It's the upside down nature of the kingdom. And they just don't understand it, because Jesus is just going to so completely disappoint them. Even though he is the one who was promised. He is the one who was promised in the prophets, and all through the Old Testament, you see these whispers of Jesus, the Messiah. And yet when he comes, he's such a disappointment. And they're crying out for him to save them. And they're crying out to the right place. They're just not going to get what they thought they were going to get. And the disciples watched all this. And in verse 16, it kind of talks about how the disciples did not understand all this. And it was only when Jesus had been glorified that they understood that all these things had to happen. Glorified in this context basically means the resurrection. When John's gospel talks about the gospel of glory, Jesus' glory is talking about the resurrection. And so it's not until the resurrection that they understand these things. So we are in an amazing position today because we live in the age and the light of the resurrection, which means that we could understand these things better than those crowds, perhaps. And yet, we cry out, don't we? We cry out in this age, we cry out for our hosannas to be heard. In the story, I wonder, you know, the cries are crying out for salvation, for Jewish autonomy, for the end of the Romans. The disciples are crying out, like, what's going on? Why is Jesus doing this? What does this all mean? The Pharisees are crying out that Jesus is a troublemaker and this man needs to be stopped. And they utterly reject his claim to kingship. And yet our world today, we fast forward 2,000 years, and have we changed that much? Are we not also still crying out? Are we not crying out for deliverance, for a vaccine? Are we not crying out to get back to normal? That seems like what we're crying out for. And so much of the world cries out. And I have two thoughts about it. One is that they're just crying out to the wrong place. We cry out, don't we, to scientists and to governments and to experts and to vaccines, that somehow we shout Hosanna at them. We pray, save us from this terrible thing. Get us back to normal. But do we cry out to the one who actually has the power to save, to change, to remake, to remodel, to build something new? I think when we see the world around us and they have that crying out, I understand it because I cry out for that stuff too. And because in it, I recognize there's an echo, isn't there? There's an echo when the people around us who don't know Jesus, who don't know that he is the person who can bring us salvation, and they cry out for salvation, isn't that an echo of humanity crying out for the new creation. Isn't that what's going on? We cry out, actually, we want this to be made new. We want this to be made right. We want this to go away. We want things to be good and whole and complete. So I understand it. It's really kind of understandable, I think, that the world cries out for salvation, but it doesn't know where to cry out to. But we do. And his name is Jesus. Ultimately, Jesus is the one who is going to remake the world and take away the terrible sufferings and make us new in the new creation. And so as his people, as his church, yes, we can cry out to get back to normal. And I'm sure there are other cries on our hearts. I'm sure there's like, God, could you just take away the pain and the suffering that I see in the people around me and in myself? Could you just take it away? We cry out for deliverance. Perhaps we cry out against the ruling authorities, the other forces at work in the world that try and disrupt things. Perhaps we cry out to have an end to that. And perhaps we cry out for shalom, as Paul would say, that peace that transcends understanding. Perhaps that's what we cry out for. And these are good cries, these are right cries, but my challenge is this. Can we turn our cries into prayers? Can we turn our cries into prayers? Because I think that begins to change us. It begins to change our situations. Because I really genuinely believe that prayer does change things, that without prayer we'd be in a worse state than we actually are. Our prayers matter. The cries of our hearts matter to God, and he does hear them. When people in the world cry out to governments and to scientists and for vaccines, do they always hear those cries? I don't know whether they do, but our God, our Father in heaven, hears our cries. He hears our prayers. They matter to him. He doesn't ignore them. And so I've written down some cries that perhaps we could turn into prayers in our hearts. Jesus, we pray. We cry out to know you more deeply, to trust you more completely, to worship you unreservedly with nothing else competing with you. We cry out to love our neighbours, ourselves, we cry out to love our enemies. And we pray and we cry out for your kingdom to come and your will to be done. And Jesus, we cry out for those known to you who are suffering. We are willing to share in each other's pain. We cry out and look for and long for reconciliation, healing, and that peace that transcends understanding. And so we pray, Hosanna! Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the King of Kings. We pray thee, we beg thee, save us. And indeed, we will be saved. Amen.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope and without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. God of glory, reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation. You did not despise the cross, for even in your suffering you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for our sake he died. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. In the morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till the stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored. And the Church of Christ was born, and the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel and shall not fade. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
As we come together in prayer, when I say the words, Lord, in your mercy, please respond with, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can come together at this time. We thank you that you are near us, as you promised you would be. We remember that nothing can separate us from your love. As we approach Holy Week, help us to understand the sacrifice Christ made for us. And as we cannot gather in person, we give thanks for all those who are putting together and posting worship online, enabling us to be together in spirit as we relive the Easter story. A story to fill us with hope and confidence.
Creator God, we thank you for the beauty of the earth and the signs of spring. Help us to look after your world, to recognise waste and harm, and to reduce our consumption of your precious resources. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
We thank you for the vaccine and that this will herald an end to the pandemic. We pray for wisdom for our world leaders, that they will seek the common good and share the vaccine amicably to rich and poor nations throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy,
Hear our prayer. We thank you for the NHS, for the health and care professionals who have worked tirelessly during the past year through these difficult times. We pray that they will feel your love, support and calming presence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
We pray for all those around us, and especially the elderly, those who have felt lonely and isolated, and those who found this past year very difficult. Surround them with your love and bring them comfort. Help us to be good neighbours. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
We pray for the sick, those suffering pain and those struggling with their mental health, that you will bring relief and surround them with your love and your healing touch. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. We pray for those who are struggling financially, those who are anxious about their jobs and are worried about paying bills and feeding their families. We pray that you will bring hope, soften our hearts, increase our giving, and that you will provide for them from our world of plenty. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
We pray for all those who are grieving the loss of family and loved ones. Be with them in their sorrow. Uphold them with your love and strength, and that through the generosity of love shown by others, that they will know your presence and that they are not alone. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Hi, I'm Alison, the Operations Administrator at St John's. Just a reminder of our Holy Week and Easter events that are coming up, some of which will be taking place in church and some of which will be happening online. If you want to know the full list of things taking place, just go to our website, www.stjohnsclayton.org.uk. Go to our What's On page, you'll see our calendar, and it has full details of everything that's taking place during Holy Week and also on Easter Sunday. And the same information is on our Facebook page as well. For activities that are happening in church, you don't need to register beforehand. We will be taking contact details on the day just to assist with NHS test and trace. And obviously the usual COVID-19 restrictions will be in place for everybody's health and safety. We really hope you can join us for any or all of the events that are taking place during this very special week as we build up to Easter Sunday. And we'll be having our open air Easter celebration in the churchyard on Easter Sunday morning at 9:30. If you have any queries or questions, don't hesitate to get in touch with me. My phone number is 01274 883000, or you can email me at admin@stjohnsclayton.org.uk. Have a great Palm Sunday. Take care. Bye for now.
Well, I hope, like me, you've found today's service a real encouragement. And we're now moving into Holy Week. Let's pray that God will bless us as we go. May the Father, who so loved the world that he gave his only Son, give you faith and hope. May Jesus Christ, who accepted the cup of sacrifice in obedience to the Father's will, keep you steadfast as you walk with him in the way of the cross. And may the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us to suffer with Christ, that we may share his glory, set your minds on life and peace. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.